Chapter 1.
You're such a slob.
I turn around. Francis is shaking his head in disgust. Are you talking to me? I say. He rolls his eyes.
No, I was talking to the drinking fountain, he says.
Then he mutters something about
the messiest kid at PS38.
Just a little background here. PS38 is our middle school. Francis is my best friend, and yeah, I'm a little messy. So what? Well, excuse me for not being as organized as you, Francis. We can't all have color-coded underwear. Yank! Francis starts to swing his notebook at me, then stops himself. He doesn't want any teachers to catch him clonking me in the head. Around here, assault with a 3-ring binder is worth at least a couple of detentions, and Francis never gets detention. Ever.
Hello, Nate.
Hi, Mrs. Sirwicky, I say.
And hello,
Francis, he says.
See, the detention lady doesn't even know his name. That says it all. People think it's weird that Francis and I are so tight, and you know what? They've got a point. He and I are total opposites. Here's what I mean. The official All About Francis Study Guide. 1. He is a trivia fanatic.
Do you know that the pop-up toaster was invented in 1919 by a mechanic named Yak Yak Yak?
Hey, I like trivia too, but it's good trivia. Like sports stats and movie lines. Stuff you can actually use. 2. He's a studying machine. Francis wants to be an epidemiologist, whatever that is, someday, so he takes school super seriously. But he's not obnoxious about it. Like some people I know, including Gina.
Ho hum, another day, another A, plus.
3. He's a cat person.
Oogie woogie boogie woogie snoogie wiggums.
The less said about this unfortunate part of his personality, the better. 4. He acts like my Aunt Patty.
Chew at least 20 times before swallowing, and then floss after eating.
He doesn't have a mustache like Aunt Patty, but otherwise the similarities are uncanny. Okay, here's an FYI. Francis isn't really this much of a weenie. I think I wrote this study guide back when I was annoyed with him for hanging air fresheners in our treehouse. Anyway, 5. He's an only child. Him. Spoiled rotten. Me. Treated rotten. Here's my sister Ellen now.
Noogie noogie.
6. He's a total neat freak.
Of course I iron my tube socks. Who doesn't?
Maybe the neatness thing should have gone at the top of the list. I've known Francis since kindergarten, and he's always been Captain Tidy Pants. Back then, he wouldn't even play in the sandbox without a package of wet wipes.
Look,
he says as we walk down the hall.
That poster's not straight.
Oh, brother. What's the big deal about a crooked poster? I ask him.
It looks sloppy,
he answers, frowning.
It detracts from the hallway's overall feng shui.
Feng who?
Gesundheit, Teddy says, giving me thwack with his binder.
Hilarious, Teddy, I grumble, rubbing the bump on my head. You've still got it. Which isn't saying much. Shove!
Come on, guys, Francis says. We've got science.
Great. Science with Mr. Galvin. Ever sit through a late-night infomercial for one of those useless kitchen appliances? That's what science is like. Except you can't change the channel.
I'm handing back your homework assignments, people. Nicely done, Gina,
Mr. Galvin says. She flashes her usual smirk.
Francis, great job.
He says next. I look over and Francis holds up his packet so I can see it. An A. No big surprise there. But it's good news just the same, because Francis and I did the homework together, so if he got an A, then obviously I must have.
Nate!
Comes Mr. Galvin's voice.
See me at my desk, please.
Huh? See me at my desk? Where's my nicely done? Where's my great job?
Let's discuss your homework, shall we?
Okay, I say a little nervously. No, a lot nervously.
This is, without a doubt, he announces, his voice rising, the messiest homework assignment I've ever seen!
I hear snickering behind me. Nice of him to broadcast that little nugget to the entire class. Couldn't he have chewed me out in private? Whatever, I'm not going down without a fight. But I got all the right answers.
I couldn't even read your answers,
Mr. Galvin goes on. He's in full-blown rant mode now.
Your handwriting is completely illegible.
He flips my packet over.
Except for, this. The Adventures of Lukewarm Private Eye.
Whoops. Didn't realize I started my latest comic masterpiece on the back of my science homework. He's, a detective. He's, you know, he solves mysteries.
You like mysteries?
He asks, pushing my homework across his desktop.
Try figuring out how you're going to pass this class!
Yikes. Did this ever blow up in my face? 3 minutes ago I thought I had an A. Now I'm practically getting expelled. Mr. Galvin's voice follows me as I shuffle back to my seat.
I want that assignment on my desk tomorrow completely redone. No sloppy handwriting, no food stains, and no cartoons.
I slump into my desk. Then, pip, a note hits me on the head. It's from Francis. I sneak a quick peek at Mr. Galvin, who's busy showing Mary Ellen Popowski how to light a Bunsen burner without setting her hair on fire. The coast is clear. The note is in code. Francis and I spend a lot of time making sure that nobody can read it. What good is having a secret code if half the world knows what it means? Well, all right, I'll translate it, but don't tell anybody else. Here's what Francis wrote.
Old Fossil Face got so mad.
I write back in code. I thought his head was going to explode. So he writes in code.
He almost had a heart attack.
And I use the code to write back. No, he has no heart. And he gets back to me.
I'll help you redo your homework.
Good old Francis. Finally, the bell rings and we file out. That's the only thing I like about science. It feels great when it's over.
Look, guys,
Francis says, pointing.
Want to hit the Chronicle meeting?
A poster on the wall says, Chronicle, meeting today, 3:15, room 216. Be there.
The yearbook?
Teddy asks. The Chronicle is a joke, I say.
Which is exactly why we should go to a meeting,
Francis says.
Let's make a Chronicle that's memorable for a change.
Well, Teddy chuckles,
last year's was pretty memorable, right?
Yeah, for all the wrong reasons. Major mistakes in last year's Chronicle. A bunch of pictures were upside down. Next to Chad's name, it said, most likely to be first woman elected president. The cafetorium ladies were identified as the boys' cross-country team. Practically everybody's name was misspelled, including Francis Pope, Frantic's puppy, Teddy Ortiz, Tubby Orzitz, and me, Nate Wright, Nut Wait. A whole bunch of clubs and teams got completely left out. Dee Dee, president of the drama club.
It's not fair!
On the lower right corner of every page, there was a really cool picture of a bulldog. There's only one problem. Our mascot is a bobcat. The book was dedicated to Mrs. Godfrey, a great friend and teacher. Says who? What a train wreck. There were more mistakes than Chad has freckles. I started to count them, but I got bored when I hit triple digits.
You know why all that stuff went wrong, don't you?
Francis asks.
Sure,
Teddy and I answer together. Nick Blonsky. Nick Blonsky was the Chronicle editor last year. I could have told you he'd screw up. Anyone who spends that much time with his finger up his nose doesn't exactly inspire confidence. Who's going to be the editor this year, I ask.
ABB, Teddy says. Anybody but Blonsky.
Ha! I say.
Well, whoever it is,
Francis says as we walk into the meeting.
It's bound to be an improvement.
Chapter 2. Oh, no.
No.
No!
This meeting of the yearbook committee will now come to order. Bam, bam, bam.
Gina? She's the editor?
Teddy groans.
Well, what'd you expect? Whispers Francis. Gina wants to be in charge of everything.
Bingo. That's one reason she's about as popular as a fire drill during recess. Here are a few others. What makes Gina so obnoxious? I'll need a lot of paper for this.
Shut up!
1. She's always bragging about how smart she is.
I got a 105. That's a perfect 100 plus 5 points of extra credit. Oh, you only got a 99? Bummer.
2. She's the world's biggest suck-up.
Mrs. Godfrey, your new outfit makes you look like a supermodel.
Yeah, a super-size model. 3. Her favorite hobby is getting other people in trouble.
Mr. Galvin, Nate looked at the answers in the back of the textbook after you told us not to.
Oh, he did he?
Erk.
4. Thanks to her, there's more work for the rest of us.
I finished the worksheet, Mr. Staples.
Already? Guess I didn't make it challenging enough. I'll fix that. Here, class, after you complete the first sheet like Gina has, do this ridiculously confusing advanced calculus.
Yay!
What? I'm still working on question number 1.
5. She's got a big mouth.
Chester! Nate's drawing a mean cartoon about you!
What? Let me see. Stomp, stomp.
Uh-oh, we're out of time, but the list never ends! I hate you! And now back to the meeting starring Pushy McBoss Around.
Order, everyone. I said order.
Okay, Gina, we hear you, I tell her. You can lose the stinking hammer.
It's called a gavel, genius, and I'll hang on to it, thanks. It could come in handy.
Nice. Now she's threatening us. Is this a yearbook meeting or a game of whack-a-mole? Gina obviously doesn't care that nobody's paying attention to her, because she launches into some brag fest about taking the Chronicle in a new direction. Sounds good, I tell the guys. She can go her way and we'll go ours. Come on.
No, Francis says. We can't leave.
Why not? Francis nods towards Gina.
Do we really want the yearbook in her hands? She'll make it all about herself. Now that's bad.
You thought a Blonsky-ized Chronicle was scary? A Gina-fied one would be a nightmare.
The Gina-cull, published by the students of PS 38, especially Gina. Dedicated to Gina Hemphill-Toms, our beloved editor and our dynamic art director.
You're right, I say. We can't just sit here and let Gina make herself the queen of the yearbook.
So what do?
Teddy asks.
Watch, I whisper.
I shoot my hand into the air.
Ahem. Ahem.
Gina peers at me suspiciously.
What do you want?
I want to nominate Francis as editor of the Chronicle. Everyone looks stunned, especially Francis.
Me?
He says.
Excuse me,
Gina sputters, her cheeks flushing.
But I'm already the editor.
Oh, is that right? Was there an election, or did you just take over? Gina's face gets redder.
I volunteered, if that's what you mean, she growls. I volunteered first.
And Francis volunteered second, I say. What's the difference?
Well,
Francis says,
technically I didn't really
I give Francis a shove. The two of you can share the job, I pronounce. Now she's turning a color I've never even seen before. She points the gavel right between my eyes.
There can't be two editors, she hisses.
Why not? Says Mrs. Hickson, coming into the room. We learned last year that one editor isn't necessarily the best answer. Mrs. Hickson, the school librarian and yearbook advisor, is also the only person who's ever sent Gina to detention. And now she's shooting down Little Miss Control Freak's master plan to take over the Chronicle.
Ha! A yearbook is a team effort, Gina. Why don't you and Francis work as co-editors?
Yes, ma'am.
I'm really starting to like this woman.
Nate, she says.
Hmm?
Over here.
Uh-oh, maybe I spoke too soon. She holds up a book.
Recognize this?
Sure, I just borrowed it from the library last week. Zach Birdwatcher Takes the Cake. It was really good. Zach's this kid who gets a parrot for his birthday, but the parrot disappears, so then... But she cuts me off.
This book was in perfect condition when you took it out, and look at it now!
She flips through it.
Perhaps you'd care to explain why there are orange smudges on every single page?
I might have been eating some cheese doodles while I was reading it. She frowns.
I see. And what about this stain on the cover?
Oh, I... I had a little root beer accident.
And look at this, she goes on. The spine is broken, the binding is falling apart, and the cover is torn.
I gulp. It is pretty beat up. Sometimes stuff gets a little crumpled in my locker.
A little crumpled? This looks like it went through a trash compactor, she shouts. Wait, aren't librarians supposed to be quiet? This isn't the first time we've had a discussion like this.
Yeah, I know. A couple months ago, I had a total space cadet moment and drew in a library book. That went over like a turd in a punch bowl.
Nate, she says. People are different. Some are neat, and others are messy.
Yes, and some enjoy listening to grown-ups flap their gums, and others don't. Can we move on?
But when being messy and careless affects other people or their belongings, well, then it becomes a problem.
Problem sounds so negative. How about lovable quirk?
Lecture's over, she says, giving me one last hairy eyeball.
I'll let you get back to your meeting.
Francis and Teddy are on one of the computers. I pull up a chair.
Hey, I say.
Hey,
Teddy replies.
What was that all about?
Francis asks. I start to say, nothing. But who am I kidding? I can't keep secrets from the guys. I give them a recap of my one-on-one with old Silent but Deadly.
See?
Francis says.
I told you being messy would get you in trouble.
No, I remind him. You told me I was a pig.
A slob, not a pig.
Francis corrects me.
Slob, pig. Let's compromise,
Teddy says.
You're a slig.
Clever, I say. What are you guys doing?
Alphabetizing all the portraits,
Francis says at the computer.
Some of these are a riot.
Here's Randy, Teddy says.
He looks like he's about to throw up,
I say.
You'd throw up too if you looked like Randy,
Francis adds.
Lights, camera, Dee-Dee!
Ugh, that smile is so fake.
Good thing she flossed that day.
Yikes, check out the zit on Artur. Wait, is that a zit?
It's either a zit or a small island. Let's find your picture, Nate,
Francis grins.
Let's not, I answer quickly.
Ah, here you are,
Francis says. Then everyone gathers around. Teddy's busting a gut.
Oh, man, I'd forgotten how bad your picture turned out.
Yeah, because it didn't happen to you, that's why. Trust me, I remember it just fine. It was another episode of Worst Days Ever, Special School Picture Edition. Dad always makes me dress up for my school picture. But I hate ties. Hold still. The day was not going well.
Hi, handsome. Where's the fashion show?
But during lunch, things started looking up.
I hear that new girl likes you.
She does? She's sitting with a tray of food at a cafetorium table, and I decide to introduce myself.
Hello there. He's so suave.
My name's Nate, I say.
What's Snoop's sploosh?
I tried to be casual, but accidentally leaned on the tray and the whole thing flung up, plastering my shirt with food.
Then, at that very moment, an announcement over the cafetorium speaker.
Students with last names ending in V or W, report to the gym for school pictures.
I can't get my picture taken wearing this.
The kids in my group were all girls, so I can't borrow any of their shirts. Luckily, the school picture guy came to the rescue. Or so I thought.
Never fear, kid. I've got you covered. I have an extra sweater just for such an emergency. Put this on, my boy.
Okay. Seconds later. This sweater is kind of...
Say cheese, champ! Wait, I'm not ready!
Click.
Next!
Ta-da! There it is. The lamest picture in the history of the school. Maybe in the history of the universe. The sweater is more for a girl, and it says Lil Imp with a heart-shaped smiley face on it. I've got one eye shut and a hand thrown up to block the flash.
Wow,
Teddy gasps, picking himself up off the floor.
And I thought joining the yearbook committee was gonna be boring.
Shut up, I grumble.
Oh, don't take it so seriously, Nate,
Francis says.
All we're saying is there's something funny about embarrassing pictures.
Yeah, he's right. I just hate looking like such a dweeb. I'd much rather be on the other side of the camera.
Chapter 3
Candids, I say to Francis and Teddy as we leave the yearbook meeting. That's what the Chronicle needs, more candids.
Yes, definitely, Teddy says.
What exactly is a candid?
It's a picture you take of someone when they don't know you're taking it,
Francis explains. Right. Sometimes the picture's funny all by itself, I say.
Like the one where Coach John's toupee blew off.
And sometimes you make it funny by adding a caption. Like the one where Dee Dee's staring at Chad and the caption says, Chad, did you fart?
Ha!
Now that you mention it,
says Francis, rubbing his chin in a co-editor of the yearbook sort of way.
Last year's Chronicle had almost no candids. Yet another reason it stank on ice,
Teddy says.
Ahem.
Last year's Chronicle did not stink on ice.
Hey, look, everybody. It's Nick Blonsky, here to share all his yearbook expertise.
No offense, Nick, but isn't that like the captain of the Titanic offering to give sailing lessons? Nick Fact. He's a total liar.
I'm being recruited for the Olympic water skiing team.
There is no Olympic water skiing team.
Right, I meant alpine skiing.
Oh, it stank all right,
Teddy tells him.
It had more mistakes than Nate's last math test.
Those mistakes weren't my fault, Nick whines. The proofs were perfect when I sent them to the printer. That's where all the problems started.
Ugh. Nick spits when he talks. Every time he says a P-word, he practically floods the hallway. Anybody got a towel?
Well, Teddy says, Francis is the co-editor this year.
He'll make sure the Chronicle's mistake-free, I say.
Nick snorts so hard he blows a little snot bubble out of his nose.
That's so nasty.
Good luck, he sneers.
There's no such thing as a mistake-free yearbook. Something always happens to mess it up.
How nice of him to offer a few words of encouragement,
Francis says, rolling his eyes.
What a Dorcas Maximus,
Teddy grumbles. Forget about him, you guys, I tell them. Let's go find Mrs. Godfrey. You're probably thinking, what? Since when do I go looking for she who must not be named? Especially since she's been on a total rampage lately.
Recent meltdowns, starring Mrs. Godfrey, a.k.a. Butterbutt, a.k.a. Death Breath, a.k.a. Lady Gargoyle. Monday.
Excuse me, ladies. Did I interrupt your important conversation with some silly old schoolwork? How rude of me!
Tuesday.
Did I say page 27, question 30?
No!
I said page 30, question 27. Try listening for a change.
Yesterday.
You were supposed to sharpen your pencil, not spill shavings all over the floor. Sweep that up!
Okay, I'm stumped, Teddy says. Why are we going to see Mrs. Godfrey? Because she is in charge of the audiovisual room, I explain. I need to borrow one of the school's cameras so I can start my career as Nate Wright, yearbook photographer.
Francis gives me one of those are-you-crazy looks.
Dream on, Nate. Those cameras are only for teachers.
Uh-huh, I nod. Teachers and yearbook editors.
Huh?
She'll let you borrow a camera, Francis, I point out.
She likes you.
She really likes you.
No, what she likes is the fact that I don't do stupid things,
he answers.
Like bring a can of spray cheese to class.
Psst! That may have been a mistake, I admit.
You're always making mistakes,
Francis says, curling his fingers into air quotes.
What if I put myself on the line and borrow the camera, and then you spill lemonade on it? Or drop it in a bag of cheese doodles? Or get jelly all over the lens?
Teddy chuckles and gives me a shove.
You do have a way with food.
Francis is still babbling.
The bottom line is, if you break the camera,
I'm not going to break it, I object.
Or ruin it somehow,
he goes on. I'm not going to ruin it.
Then I'm not the one spending a month in detention,
he finishes. Just the thought of getting in trouble gives Francis a stress rash. Listen, that'll never happen, I tell him.
I swear. Secret swear?
Secret swear, I say. I guess I should explain what a secret swear is. It's like a pact between me and Francis. Back in third grade, we were already best friends, but we wanted to make it official. So we climbed into Francis's treehouse and wrote this out. Agreement. I hereby agree to tell Francis one embarrassing secret.
I hereby agree to tell Nate one embarrassing secret.
And we both promise to never tell another person, alive or dead. Signed, Nate Wright, age 8.
Signed, Francis Pope, age 8.
Yo-ho-ho!
Who knows why we put a skull and crossbones on it. I guess we were in a pirate phase. Anyway, I told him my biggest secret, and he told me his. And no, I won't let you know what we said. Then they wouldn't be secrets. Duh. We've never told anyone, not even Teddy. It's a pretty big deal. This sounds kind of cheesy, but it's basically saying that you trust someone with anything. A secret swear is way more than a promise. It's a stone-cold lock. Francis takes a deep breath.
Okay,
he says finally.
I'll go ask Mrs. Godfrey for the camera, but stay out of sight, Nate. If she finds out the camera's for you, she'll never let me borrow it.
He's right, says Teddy matter-of-factly. Mrs. Godfrey hates you. Yeah, but why? I say. What did I ever do to her? Teddy snickers. Well, don't answer that, I say quickly. From around the corner, we hear a door open. Mrs. Godfrey's voice comes floating up the hallway.
It's a very expensive piece of equipment, so make certain you treat it gently.
I will,
Francis says. A few seconds later, here comes Francis, with the camera.
You got it,
I exclaim. Let me see.
Let's wait till we get outside,
Francis whispers.
Remember, Mrs. Godfrey thinks I borrowed it for myself.
We step out into the schoolyard, and Francis hands over the camera. It's in a leather case, and there's a tag on the strap that says, Property of PS-38. How fancy can you get?
Cool, I say. You heard what Mrs. Godfrey said, right?
Francis asks.
About it being expensive?
Yes, relax, will you? I tell him. All I'm gonna do is take a few pictures. Nothing bad is gonna happen.
Are you sure?
Nab.
Or do you want to rethink that?
Yeah. Great. It's Randy Betancourt and his band of merry morons. As usual, he's acting like a total slime ball.
Give it back, I growl.
Randy just smirks.
Make me,
he jeers.
Yeah, make him. You tell him, Randy.
What can we do? If Randy were just one guy, the three of us could take the camera back. But he's never just one guy, and we're no match for his whole posse.
Let's see what little Nady Poo is hiding in his purse,
Randy says.
It's not a purse, butthead,
Teddy says. Randy opens his mouth to speak, but then... Coach John walks by. He hasn't seen us yet, but he might. Randy nods at his buddies, and they quickly form a wall to block him from Coach John's view. So much for the whole teacher-to-the-rescue thing.
You're right, Randy says. It's not a purse. It's an airplane! Watch it fly! Zing!
Randy and his posse scatter. I watch in horror as the leather case soars into the sky. In about 5 seconds, that camera's going to smash into a million pieces on the pavement. Unless it doesn't hit the pavement. I start running. I've got to make the greatest catch ever. Or else. Chapter 4.
The Pathetic Misadventures of Randy Butt in Court. Sixth grade bully. Bully crossed out. Moron!
Note, he should be in seventh grade, but he flunked kindergarten.
I did not flunk kindergarten, shove. I flunked preschool. Today's episode, Camera Crazy, with mystery guest star. Earlier today in the schoolyard. I'm such a loser. Everyone hates me. Even we hate you, and we're your posse. Hey, I know. I'll bully someone to feel better about myself. Good plan, Randy. Ho, ho, there's a likely victim. What? But that's Nate Wright. He's cool, and he's tough. Don't try it, Randy. You're no match for him. No problem. I'm a total wusspot, but you guys can protect me. Besides, I want to check out that case he's carrying. Tippy toe, tippy toe. I'll take that, Nab. Huh? Oh, got it!
Randy, look! It's Coach John! Uh-oh.
Better get rid of the evidence. Fling!
Ah! Randy threw the camera.
Egad, this is a job for
Rip Ultronate! Even with my turbo speed, I won't reach it before it smashes on the ground. There's only one chance. Super suction breath! Like a giant vacuum cleaner, Ultronate inhales. And the camera case is drawn into the ultra vortex. Zip.
That was amazing!
I swallowed a few bugs, but it was worth it.
Uh-oh! I better scram!
Hey, Randy's escaping!
Not on my watch! Foom! Going somewhere, Randy? Snag! How does detention sound?
Ultronate, you're the greatest!
But I'm still a loser.
The Ultra End.
Very interesting, Dad says over my shoulder, and I almost jump out of my jammies. Doesn't anybody ever knock around here? How much of this really happened? The part where I'm wearing tights and flying through the air is made up, I tell him.
Got it.
He chuckles and sits down on the bed. Oh, yippee. Looks like Dad's in one of his tell-me-everything-about-your-life moods.
Did Randy really get detention?
I snort. Are you kidding? He almost never gets in trouble, even though he does detention-y stuff all the time.
And that's coming from an authority on the subject,
Dad says. But not in a mean way. He's just busting my chops a little bit.
So what did happen? He asks.
Well, I say, Randy chucked the camera way up in the air, and it wasn't like there was any place soft for it to land. So I bombed across the schoolyard. I've never run that fast in my whole life.
And did you catch it? Dad asks.
I was about to, I grumble. It was going to be the most amazing catch of all time. Then Kim Kressley got in my way.
Yep!
Who's Kim Kressley?
Just some girl, I say quickly. No way I'm telling Dad that Kim wants me to be her love puppet. Parents get all weird about that stuff. Anyway, I continue. While I was trying to, get past Kim, guess who came bumbling along? Nick Blonsky. And then, whoomp!
Let me guess, Dad says.
Nick caught it. I nod in disgust. Yes, and believe me, that was a total miracle. He was on my SPOF flag football team last fall, and he never caught anything.
Well, at least the camera wasn't broken, Dad notes.
Exactly, that's what I told him, but he still laid this huge lecture on me. That's school property. You're treating it like a plaything. That's preposterous. Dad notices the case next to my bed and opens it. Wow, he exclaims.
This is a nice camera.
Uh-huh, I agree. And starting tomorrow, I'll be using it to shoot some killer candids, like Mr. Galvin's dentures falling out, or Coach John's plumber's butt.
Well, killer, there's more to being a yearbook photographer than playing gotcha, he says.
Now, go to sleep. It's getting late. He turns to leave. Oh, Dad, I say. Want to see my new tattoo?
Yerk!
He turns with a horrified look.
Your what?
Click. Gotcha. On the walk to school the next morning, the guys and I talk strategy. What do you think is the best place for candids? I ask.
The cafetorium, probably, Francis says. Or the library.
Yes, the library! Teddy laughs. Chester fell asleep in there last week, and he was drooling all over the beanbag chair.
Now that would have made a great candid.
If Chester caught you taking his picture, he'd probably kill you,
Francis points out.
Yeah, but you don't get caught, I say, when you know what you're doing.
Right,
Francis says, rolling his eyes.
I forgot I was talking to a master photographer.
Nate,
says a girl passing the other direction.
Nice picture.
So funny, her friend chimes in. What was that supposed to mean? I ask the guys. I haven't even taken any pictures yet. Teddy points at the bulletin board.
I think they were talking about that one.
Huh? Which one? I ask. It's the shot of me that the school picture guy took.
Lousy picture. Try again on retake day. Next Thursday in the gym.
That's me, I sputter.
Brilliant observation,
Francis deadpans.
Do you like the poster?
Gina says. It's crude, but effective.
Gina, I should have known.
You think you're funny, Gina? I snap. I never said you could use this. What's the big idea?
The big idea was to let people know about retake day. Genius,
she says. How? By plastering my picture all over the school?
Oh, relax, she huffs. You're on one poster.
She pulls some sheets from under her arm.
I used plenty of other pictures, too. Look, see?
She says with an innocent little grin.
A whole bunch of us made posters.
That's different. You used my real school portrait. Those are fake, I shout. You were trying to look dorky on purpose.
Yes, she smirks. Whereas for you, looking dorky comes naturally.
Behind me, Teddy snickers. Remind me to noogie him later.
Take it down if you want,
Gina shrugs.
But if you're so insecure that you can't poke fun at yourself, that's just pitiful.
I can poke fun at myself just fine, I mutter. I just don't like when she does the poking.
So what are you gonna do?
Teddy asks. I open my backpack and pull out the camera. I have an idea. It's still a little fuzzy, but it's starting to come into focus. Chapter 5. Skippy has $20. He buys 4 bags of tortilla chips to bring to Pepper's party. Each bag costs $2.60. Sales tax is 5%. How much money does Skippy have left? Oh, that's an easy one. The answer is nobody cares.
I hate problems like this.
Plus, what's up with these stupid names? Pepper sounds more like a horse than a person, and the only Skippy I've ever known was that labradoodle that used to poop every day in Francis's mom's garden. Uh-oh, I feel a yawn coming on, and that's never a good idea during math. First, Mr. Staples gets a little squirrely if you look even a tiny bit bored.
Oh, was I not being interesting enough for you? My apologies.
And second, your best friend might almost kill you by choosing exactly the wrong moment, as in right when you're yawning, to toss you a note.
Flip. Nate!
Mr. Staples jumps up from his desk.
Are you all right?
I quickly spit out the note and stuff it into my pocket.
Yeah, I'm okay,
I tell him. Just a frog in my throat.
Why don't you go drink some water? He suggests.
Not a bad idea. I'll get a 2-minute break from Skippy and Pepper, and I'll get to read this note that I halfway choked on. I flick Francis's head. Thanks to you, I say.
Sorry, Francis says.
I step into the hallway and fish the note from my pocket. It's a little moist, but readable.
How's OC going?
Not so hot, that's how. My target isn't cooperating. OC stands for Operation Candid. It's my plan to get even with Gina for that little stunt she pulled. She wants to put a goofy-looking picture of me on a poster? Fine. I'll put an even goofier picture of her in the yearbook. There's just one minor problem. I don't have a goofy-looking picture of Gina, and I can't seem to get one either because, well, this will explain why. Say cheese doodles! Confessions of a yearbook photographer. I slipped quietly into the library, the natural habitat of my target. There she is. Academica repulsiva. Commonly known as the pointy-nosed grade grubber. I followed her for 2 days, hoping to get a dynamic action shot. But no matter where she went, and no matter how many pictures I took, click, library, click, cafetorium, click, schoolyard, click, hallway, they all look exactly the same. See what I mean? Gina just doesn't do goofy things. I always knew she was obnoxious, but until now I didn't realize how boring she is. All she does is study.
Ahem!
Ugh, it's Nick.
What are you doing here?
He says. Hey, now that's friendly. I come right back at him. What are you doing here? He puffs out his chest.
For your information, I happen to be hall monitor.
Sounds about right. Hall monitors are dorks.
You're supposed to be in class.
A spray of Nick spit flies everywhere.
I could report you.
For what? I say. Getting a drink of water? Get lost, Nick. Go annoy somebody else. I brush past him and stalk back into the math room, slamming the door behind me. Whoops, that was kind of loud.
If you're feeling better, Nate, please resume your work, Mr. Staples says. Quietly.
What's the matter?
Teddy whispers as I flop back into my seat.
Your ears.
Nate, fact. My ears turn bright red when I get mad. I roll my eyes and wave him off. There's no need to tell him what a weasel Nick is. He already knows. Everybody does. I slog through the rest of math. In case you were wondering, Skippy has exactly $9.08 left. And then, just as the bell rings at the end of the period, things start looking up for Operation Candid.
Gina!
Dee Dee says.
Wanna jump rope in the schoolyard?
Okay.
Gina replies.
Did you hear that, guys?
I exclaim as we file out of class.
Here's my big chance.
Teddy looks confused.
To jump rope?
No, genius! To take pictures of Gina jumping rope. She's about as graceful as a rock in a blender, I continue. I'll bet I can get some great shots of her looking like a total doofus. Operation Candid is on. I'll grab the camera.
I open my locker and... Then I root around in the mess.
What's the matter?
Francis asks.
Nothing, nothing.
I answer, my throat tightening. It's just that I put it away and...
The camera?
Teddy says in disbelief.
But I saw you with it during lunch.
It's here somewhere, I assure him as my heart starts pounding through my chest. But it's not here somewhere. With my palms turning sweaty, I paw through the pile again. And again. I'm in full panic mode now. Then I hear Francis behind me.
I knew it.
What? I ask. My voice sounds far away.
You lost the camera,
Francis says. No, I didn't. I just... He nods his head.
Yes, you did, Nate. Just admit it, you lost the camera. Because you're so messy.
I did not lose it, I protest.
I'm... Oh, then where is it?
He snaps.
I stammer.
You can't answer,
Francis says, his voice rising.
You have no idea where it is. You promised me you'd be careful with it, Nate. You swore!
I can feel my ears starting to burn. Francis isn't being fair. It's not like I left the camera lying on the ground somewhere. It was in my locker. I know it was. Francis, calm down. I was careful. I...
No, you weren't!
Francis explodes.
This is so typical, Nate. You always screw up, and then I'm the one who has to fix everything.
Now I'm mad. Well, we can't all be perfect like you, can we? I say bitterly.
I never said I was perfect,
he yells.
But at least I'm not you. At least I'm not a loser.
It's like getting punched in the face. Francis has called me a loser before, but not like this. Not like he really means it. I can feel my answer rising in my throat. Before I even know what I'm saying, before I can stop myself, I open my big, fat mouth. At least my middle name isn't Budhurst!
Whop!
Silence. For the first time, I notice the crowd. Half the school's been listening. And they just heard me break the promise I made to Francis in third grade. I told them his secret.
Ha! Budhurst? Are you sure it isn't Butthurts? Kick!
A few people laugh along with Randy. Other kids seem stunned. Francis looks pale. He opens his mouth for a second, then closes it. He shakes his head, then he turns away. Francis, wait! I catch up to him. He doesn't stop walking. Hey, I stutter. I shouldn't have. I didn't... My voice trails off. I can barely talk. I start again. Francis, I say, forcing the words out. I made a mistake. He doesn't even look at me.
So did I,
he says.
I trusted you.
Chapter 6.
He's hot on the trail of hilarity. Lukewarm private eye. One fine day, Lukewarm arrives at his office.
Good morning, Miss Terry.
Good morning, Luke.
Got any impossible cases for me to solve?
Nope.
No murders?
No.
No kidnappings?
No.
How about a really hard Sudoku?
No.
Darn it! There's never any crime around here. What's wrong with this town?
Suddenly, ring!
What? At the middle school, you say?
I'll be right over. Soon, Lukewarm drives fast. Scree wham!
What a stupid place to put a school zone sign.
Soon.
So, the camera was in your locker?
Yes, and then it was gone.
I've got it. Maybe the camera was stolen.
You think?
Aha! Hey, you surrender, you fiend! Whoomp! I've captured the thief.
What? That's no thief.
But he has a camera.
Because he's the school picture guy, you Nimrod. He wasn't even here the day the camera disappeared.
Oopsie. My bad.
The real thief must have been someone who knew I had a camera. Maybe even someone who tried to steal it once before. Hey, that's it. Yeah, that is it. Why didn't I think of it before? It's so obvious.
What's so obvious?
Dee Dee says, flopping down next to me. I just figured out who stole that camera from my locker, I tell her. Randy Betancourt.
Ho ho,
Dee Dee exclaims. Then she starts nodding like a dashboard bobblehead.
It sounds like the sort of Mondo Jerko thing he'd do, but how can you prove it?
I'm not sure, I admit. Maybe just by following him around, spying on him.
Ooh, Dee Dee says. Can I spy on him with you? I have the perfect spy costume at home. It's a real showstopper.
I'm about to tell Dee Dee that the whole point of being a spy is not to be noticed when...
Ring!
That's the first bell, Dee Dee says. Come on, let's go. Okay, okay. We walk in silence, which never happens when Dee Dee's around, but after a few minutes, she can't resist saying something.
Ahem. Correct me if I'm wrong, even though I don't think I am, but don't you usually walk to school with Francis?
Just hearing Francis's name makes my stomach hurt. I don't really want to go there, but Dee Dee's gonna keep asking until I spill my guts, so why not? Maybe I'll feel better. I'll probably never walk with Francis again, after yesterday. Dee Dee waggles her finger at me.
Never say never, Nate. Sure, Francis is upset now, but give him a little time. Find the camera and presto, you're best buds again.
Except it's about more than just the camera, I remind her.
Yes, I know, the whole Butthurst thing,
Dee Dee says, waving her hand impatiently.
Francis needs to get over himself. There are middle names way worse than that.
Like what?
Like mine, she answers. It's Dorcas.
Dorcas?
D-O-R-C-A-S.
It means gazelle, supposedly. I snicker.
Sorry, I'm picturing a gazelle named Dorcas.
Yeah, Teddy chimes in, wearing a polka dot bow tie and a pocket protector. What's up, scrub?
Teddy says.
Noogie, 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 noogie.
Good old Teddy. At least he's not mad at me. He claps his hands once, then rubs them together.
So,
he says,
what are we gonna do?
About what? I ask.
About you and Francis, fool,
he answers.
My two best friends aren't talking to each other. Where does that leave me?
I hadn't really thought of that. It's probably no fun for Teddy to be stuck in the middle. Have you, seen Francis yet today? I ask. Teddy nods as we walk down the hall.
Just a couple minutes ago, he was on his way to tell Mrs. Godfrey about the camera.
You what? There's no mistaking Mrs. Godfrey's voice. It sounds like a head-on collision between a foghorn and a chainsaw. Teddy, Dee Dee, and I sneak down the hall toward her classroom to listen in.
A camera can't just vanish, young man! Where did you see it last?
Francis isn't easy to hear.
I can't remember. I must have misplaced it.
There's a pause. Then Mrs. Godfrey's voice booms again.
This doesn't sound like you, Francis. Are you sure you lost the camera? Or did someone else lose it?
I brace myself. Here it comes.
Here's where Francis tells her the whole story.
No. It was my responsibility. I lost it. He didn't rat you out,
Teddy whispers.
What a pal!
Yeah, I mumble, feeling worse than ever. Mrs. Godfrey gives a long sigh. Ugh, I can practically smell her onion breath from here.
I'm disappointed, Francis. I expected more of you.
I wince. Hearing that from a teacher will cut Francis to the bone.
You have detention for 1 week, Mrs. Godfrey continues. And if the camera doesn't turn up during that time, you will pay the school the cost of replacing it.
Yes, ma'am,
Francis says quietly.
You may go, she tells him.
Francis, hi, I say as he comes out. Thanks for, you know, what you did for me in there.
I didn't do it for you. Hi, Teddy. Hi, Dee Dee,
he says, leaving.
Guess he's still mad at you,
Teddy says sadly.
Poor Francis,
Dee Dee cries.
We've got to help him find that camera.
I'm gonna do more than that, I mutter. Teddy looks baffled.
What do you mean?
Francis said it yesterday. I always screw up, and then he has to fix everything. So I'm going to change.
Sure you are,
Teddy says.
I am. I'll be neat. I'll be responsible.
People can't just change by snapping their fingers,
Teddy scoffs. Dee Dee's face lights up like a Christmas tree.
Not unless they're hypnotized.
All three of us speak at once.
Uncle Pedro!
Teddy's Uncle Pedro is, well, it's hard to describe him. He's sort of an inventor, magician, handyman, mad scientist sort of guy. Oh, yeah, and he hypnotizes people.
Uncle Pedro's greatest hypno hits! Number one,
he helped Dee Dee's father lose 45 pounds.
And when I clap my hands, you will find the taste of chicken fried steak repulsive.
Okay.
Number two, he cured Mrs. Godfrey of her chronic insomnia.
Can you keep her asleep until summer vacation?
Number three, after only two sessions with Uncle Pedro, Chad's parakeet no longer uses inappropriate language.
Squawk! Gee willikers! I don't even know you anymore!
No, I have never been hypnotized. But with the camera missing in action and Francis giving me the silent treatment, it might be my only hope. When school ends, the three of us make a beeline for Uncle Pedro's house. As we get close, we see a lot of signs on a totem pole out front. Palm reading, carpentry, roofing, hypnosis, knives sharpened, yoga, haircuts, live bait, music lessons, all instruments, small engine repair, landscaping.
Ah, Uncle Pedro says. My favorite nephew. Hola, Teddy.
Uncle Pedro,
Teddy says. You remember my friends Nate and Dee Dee?
Absolutely,
he says, shaking our hands. He peers at me through his Coke bottle glasses.
Ho-ho, he exclaims. You're in Agua Caliente, champ. Hot water.
Yeah, you're right, I exclaim. How'd you know that?
Lucky guess,
he says simply.
Come inside.
I was, wondering if you can make me neater, I say after we sit down.
A lot neater, Dee Dee says.
Yeah, Teddy adds. Break out the heavy artillery.
Why do you want to be neat, my friend?
Uncle Pedro asks. So I tell Uncle Pedro all about Francis and the camera and everything. Then I wait for him to put some crazy hypno whammy on me, but he just reaches behind his back, winks at me, and says,
Escoja una tarjeta. That means pick a card.
Huh? Is he serious? How's a card trick gonna help?
Any card,
he says, nodding at me. I don't get it. I was expecting him to wave a watch in my face or something. But I guess I've got nothing to lose. I slide a card from the deck and place it face down on the table.
Now flip it over.
I do, and it's the Seven of Spades.
Interesting, Uncle Pedro says. Flip it over again.
I turn the card face down.
Your card was the Seven of Spades, correct?
Uh-huh, I answer.
Flip it over one more time.
I just adore magic, Dee Dee whispers excited.
Shh, Teddy says. Okay, I say. But this is the weirdest card trick I ever... What the? The same card is now the Jack of Hearts. Hey, how'd you do that? I ask in astonishment. How'd you change it?
Me? You're the one who flipped the card over.
Well, I say, I didn't turn it into the Jack of Hearts. Uncle Pedro shrugs.
Then perhaps there is no explanation,
he says. Okay, I get it. It's a card trick. You're not supposed to know how it works. Let's move on. Can we start now? I ask Uncle Pedro. He shoots me a quizzical look.
Start what?
Well, I say a little confused. Aren't you going to hypnotize me? Uncle Pedro smiles.
How do you know I haven't already?
Chapter 7. What a rip-off, I grumble as we leave Uncle Pedro's. All he did was a cheesy card trick. What's next, balloon sculptures?
You don't feel any different?
Dee Dee asks. Not a bit, I snort. And by the way, your glasses are filthy.
Oh, Teddy, look out, you almost stepped in that puddle.
Teddy frowns.
Since when are you afraid of a puddle?
I'm not afraid of it, doofus, I answer. I just noticed it, that's all.
I just noticed something, too, Dee Dee says, scooping up handfuls of mud.
Scoop, swash, slop, fling, splorch.
Hey! Are you crazy, Dee Dee? I shout angrily. You just ruined my shirt!
No, I just proved a point, she says, grinning like the village idiot.
Whatever Uncle Pedro did worked. You're neat!
Neat? Open your eyes. I'm a mess thanks to you and your little mudball attack, I growl. Now I have to change into clean clothes. Wipe, wipe, brush, brush.
Whoa, whoa. You never cared about clean clothes before,
Teddy exclaims.
I think Dee Dee's right. You're hypnotized.
We need to make sure of it, Dee Dee announces. Let's do another test. No more mud balls, I say quickly.
Mud is so dirty.
I've got it,
Teddy says.
Look, Mr. McTeague's lawn.
Mr. McTeague is a total whack job about his lawn. No, wait. He's a total whack job, period.
What else do you call a guy who digs crabgrass out of his yard with a pair of eyebrow tweezers?
Mr. McTeague, notable quote. Ride your bike across my lawn again and I'll call the police, you punks!
Teddy sweeps his arm across the bright green grass.
It's perfect, don't you think?
Well, I say, not exactly. Maybe I just never looked at Mr. McTeague's lawn all that carefully before, but I am now, and it's definitely got issues. The grass around that tree trunk isn't evenly trimmed. That spot in the corner is a darker shade of green than the rest of the lawn. Those acorns over there look sort of random.
Did you really just say the acorns are too messy?
Teddy asks in disbelief. I'm just pointing out that they could be a bit more organized, I explain. Dee Dee's hopping up and down like a frog on a pogo stick.
Eureka! That proves it! You're a different person! I'm going to spread the word there's a new, neat Nate on the scene!
Wow, I say as Dee Dee goes skipping away. Somebody's pretty fired up about this.
Well, aren't you?
Teddy asks. I'm not sure, I say. Being hypnotized is a little weird. I feel like I'm wearing someone else's underwear. And speaking of underwear, I've been wearing the same pair of tighty-whities since this morning. That's gross. Note to self, bring backup pair of undies to school tomorrow. Dad's burning something on the stove when I walk through the kitchen door.
Hi, Nate. Want a snack? Supper won't be ready for a while.
No, thanks. I've got some work to do in my room.
Homework?
Nope, no homework tonight. I stand at my open bedroom door, taking in the mayhem. I've got something more important to do. A couple hours later, Dad knocks on my door.
Nate, supper's almost ka-wang.
Dad's lips start moving, but no sound comes out. Either he doesn't know what to say, or he just won a scholarship to mime school.
You cleaned your room,
he finally stammers.
Brilliant observation, Dad.
Yeah, I tell him.
How? Why?
With my hands. Because it was messy, I explain.
Gotta love these father-son chats. They're so deep.
Downstairs at the supper table, Ellen continues the sparkling conversation.
Okay, out with it. What's your problem?
Besides an annoying big sister, you mean? I ask.
You've got your napkin in your lap for once, she says. You haven't spilled anything yet, and you're actually chewing your food instead of wearing it.
It's called self-improvement, Ellen, a concept you're obviously too brain-dead to understand.
You know what I think,
Dad announces in that fake happy voice he uses whenever he's trying to keep Ellen and me from killing each other.
I think we should make some hot fudge sundaes.
Oh, yay!
Ellen exclaims. No thanks, I say as I put my dishes in the sink and head upstairs. Too messy. Later, Dad pokes his head in my room again.
What's this? He says. I thought you didn't have any homework.
I don't, I tell him. I'm just rewriting my class notes for social studies. He sits down on my bed, which totally messes up the blanket, but whatever, I'll fix it later.
So, this isn't something Mrs. Godfrey told you to do?
He asks as one of his eyebrows heads north. No, I just wanted to make them neater. See, this is what they looked like before. Franklin Pierce, 14th President, Nyuk-Nyuk, born November 23rd.
Hi, Spitzy, Werf, 1804, Jenny plus Nate. New Hampshire, Zep, Bobcat Pride, Hee-yah, Kung Fu Power. It's a comet, it's a meteor, it's Ultra Nate. U.S. Senator, 1837, but who really cares?
And here's what they look like now.
Good gravy, Dad says.
Class notes. Social studies. Nate Wright. Franklin Pierce, 14th President of U.S., born November 23rd, 1804, Hillsborough, New Hampshire. Parents, Anna Kendrick and Benjamin Pierce, Governor of New Hampshire. 1824, graduates from Bowdoin College. 1829, elected to New Hampshire Legislature, becomes Speaker in 1831. 1833, elected to U.S. House of Reps. 1837, begins first term as Senator. Presidential election of 1852. Franklin Pierce, Democrat, versus Winfield Scott, Whig. Popular vote, 50% Franklin Pierce, 44% Winfield Scott. Electoral college, 254% Franklin Pierce, 42% Winfield Scott. Pierce's presidency. Support for Kansas. Nebraska Act makes him unpopular in the North. Ostend Manifesto published.
Dad hands me back my notes. He's got the weirdest expression on his face. It's like half worried, half gassy. Nate, is there anything you want to tell me? Okay, here's where things get kind of dicey. I'm pretty sure Dad wouldn't be too happy about me getting hypnotized, so I can't tell him why I've turned into Joe Tidy. And if he finds out a camera disappeared from my locker, he's gonna call the school. You never want a parent to call the school. So I lie. No. Dad gives me the squint. He probably knows there's more to the story, but what can he do? Ground me for being too neat? Well, all right then. Why don't you go to sleep, Nate? It's getting late. Can I stay up and draw comics for a while? I ask, sort of as a reward for cleaning my room without being asked. He smiles. I suppose a miracle like that buys you some drawing time, but only half an hour, Nate. It's a school night. Thanks, Dad, I tell him. Then I jump into a brand new lukewarm private eye adventure. I'm just getting started when... Lights out! What? You said I had a half hour. Dad taps his watch. That was a half hour. But I haven't even started drawing yet. I barely finished measuring all the panels. Measuring them? I've never seen you draw comics using a ruler. When did that start? I flail around for a good answer. I wanted all the panels to look nice and straight, I say weakly. Dad peers down at my notebook. Well, they certainly are nice and straight, he says. And empty. Sleep tight. Chapter 8. The sun's barely up when I leave for school the next morning. I need to get there early so I can clean my locker. Whap! A newspaper hits me right in the face. Oops, says Francis. Sorry. He doesn't look very sorry if you ask me. But I'm so happy to see Francis, I don't even mind getting clocked in the face by... the Daily Courier? Francis, how come you're delivering newspapers? He doesn't look at me. He won't even slow down. I need the money, he says. I have to buy a camera. A hot wave of guilt washes over me, even though I have nothing to feel guilty about, because I didn't lose that stinking camera. I guess I could chase after Francis and tell him that, again. Or I could tell him that he doesn't need to buy the school a new camera, that I'll pay for it if I have to. Except I won't have to, once I prove that Randy took it. Then maybe Francis and I can be friends again. The school's pretty empty when I get there, and you know what? It looks good this early. It's so neat and tidy. Nate, what are you doing here at 7 a.m.? Mrs. Hickson eyes me suspiciously, which makes sense, I guess. I'm usually here an hour after school, not an hour before, if you get my drift. I want to clean my locker before homeroom, I answer. Oh, that reminds me, I say, digging into my bag. I found these overdue library books in my room last night. Hickey looks like she might kiss me. She doesn't. Whew. My goodness, Nate. This is wonderful, she gushes. I assumed you'd lost all these. Nope, I tell her. I never lose stuff, because I never throw anything away. Or at least I never used to. But now that I've been hypnotized, I'm ready to send most of what's in my locker straight to Dump City. I open my locker and... Ugh. It takes me almost 45 minutes. What a disgusting job. You wouldn't believe all the stuff that comes out of there. Locker inventory, not a complete list. 13 pairs of unwashed socks. 3 molded and moldy plastic mouthguards. 27 pencils. 2 unfinished Dr. Cesspool comics. 49 jelly beans. Half a roll of toilet paper. 2 wooden drumsticks. 2 chicken drumsticks.
Okay, those are mine!
12.3 pounds of math homework. 1 volleyball, deflated. 1 pair of Mr. Galvin's dentures. 16 empty cheese doodle bags. 1 sombrero. The head of a lawn gnome. Ouch! 6 1/3 cups of dirt, and I won't even get into how it smelled. Francis was right. I was a slob.
Psst! The pigeon has landed!
It's Dee Dee, dressed in a black spy costume. The what? Dee Dee, what are you doing?
I'm a spy, Dee Dee says, like it's supposed to be obvious. That's how we talk. The stork flies at midnight. The penguin has no feathers. See, I'm ready to be a secret agent. Where? At a bird sanctuary? I say. No, silly, she giggles. I'm going to spy on Randy Bet. I put a hand on her mouth. Here's a suggestion, 007, I whisper. Don't announce to the world who you're about to spy on. Got it, Dee Dee says a little sheepishly. From now on, I'll be low-key. Skip, 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 skip. Right, I'll believe it when I see it. Dee Dee's about as low-key as a match in a fireworks factory. Oh, and don't forget, she calls over her shoulder. After school, we're practicing for the trivia slam. My heart sinks. Oh, yeah, the trivia slam. Yippee. I guess I should fill you in. The trivia slam is like the ultimate quiz show. The questions can be about anything, and the last team standing wins. It happens every year, and it's huge. But I won't be part of it. Not now. I'm supposed to be on Francis's team, the Factoids, along with Teddy, Dee Dee, and Chad. Talk about a trivia powerhouse. As soon as we put that group together, we knew we had the goods to knock off the defending champs, Gina's geniuses. But everything's changed now. How can I be on the team if our captain won't even talk to me? When the bell rings for social studies, I'm still thinking about the trivia slam until Mrs. Godfrey gets everyone's attention.
Notebook check.
Translation. Get ready for Mrs. Godfrey to throw a conniption fit if she thinks your notebook is too sloppy, or too unorganized, or too red. On a normal day, a notebook check, for me anyway, is a one-way ticket to detention. But today's not a normal day.
Let's start with your notebook, Nate, Nab.
Jumpin' Jiminy!
Mrs. Godfrey's eyes look ready to pop out of their sockets as she flips through my notebook, staring at page after perfect page.
No rips, no smudges, no food stains. Nate, what's gotten into you?
5 minutes with Uncle Pedro, that's what. But I just shrug my shoulders. I decided I wanted to be neater, that's all, I say. Honest enough.
Well, the difference is like night and day, she says. Such a turnaround deserves an A double plus.
An A double plus? Holy cow! She's never given you one of those, has she, Gina?
Shut up, jerkface, and tell me what's going on. You're up to something, I can tell, Gina says.
Isn't she charming? And so friendly, too. There's no mystery, Gina. I've cleaned up my act.
Act is right. You're faking.
This is killing her. Does it look like I'm faking? I ask. Get used to the new me, Gina. Neatness is now my way of life. And speaking of neatness, how about wiping your nose? There's a gigantic booger hanging off it. Ha! That's me one, Gina zero. And you want to know the best part? The rest of the day goes exactly the same way. In English, Ms. Clark gives me extra credit for my phenomenal penmanship. In math, Mr. Staples tells everybody my homework is the Mona Lisa of bar graphs. Even old Fossil Face is impressed.
This lab report is absolute perfection.
Aw, shucks. Not too shabby, right? As I head for my locker after class, I realize something. I didn't get yelled at today. Not even once. Who knew it was this easy to make teachers happy?
Psst, Nate.
Looks like Dee Dee's still in not-so-secret agent mode. What's up? I ask as I turn the corner.
The pigeon has almost landed, she whispers.
Not this again. Try it in English, Dee Dee, I tell her. I can't speak spy.
I followed Randy all day, she says.
You did?
Yes, and I saw him showing something to his gang, something he didn't want anyone else to see.
Whisper, whisper.
Pretty suspicious, don't you think?
Dee Dee goes on.
I bet it was the camera.
That does sound kind of suspicious, I admit. Amazed that Dee Dee actually turned up some useful information.
I'll continue my investigation tomorrow, she says. I've got another fabulous outfit planned.
That's good. The Bride of Dracula look might not work 2 days in a row.
Now, come on. Come on, Nate, Dee Dee says. Let's not keep our fellow factoids waiting.
My stomach drops off a cliff. You know what? I'm gonna skip the trivia slam, Dee Dee. You guys will do fine without me, and Francis doesn't want me there anyway.
Sure he does,
Dee Dee chirps a little too quickly. Oh, yeah? I mutter. Did you ask him? She gets a little fidgety. I've talked to him about it a couple times, yes, she answers. Well, what did he say? In his exact words. Dee Dee mumbles nervously.
He said that he didn't care if you came or not.
Just what I thought. See ya.
Nate, wait! Francis didn't say you couldn't come. He just said that,
that he doesn't care, I finished for her. Yeah, I heard you the first time. I swallow the lump in my throat and start home. They really will do fine without me. The factoids, I mean. They can beat anybody as long as they've got Francis. He's always been a trivia geek. I come to the edge of the little woods. If I go to the left and stay on the sidewalk, I'll be home in 10 minutes. But if I go to the right, there's a shortcut through the woods that leads straight to my street. It's a little muddy sometimes, but it's fast. I go to the left. I don't want to get my shoes dirty.
Chapter 9.
I'm starting to hate being neat. Everything takes so long. Like right now, for example, I'm getting ready for school picture retake day, and I've been working on my hair for half an hour.
Bam, bam!
Ellen's pounding on the door. Pretty ridiculous, right? Nobody spends that long on his hair. Then Ellen comes in. Well, almost nobody. But I can't help it. Whatever Uncle Pedro did when he hypnotized me is working too well. At this point, I couldn't be messy even if I tried. Sure, there are some upsides to being a neatnik. Like my grades. All of a sudden, I'm getting A's in everything. The teachers love me now. Plus, I'm not spending my afternoons in detention. I haven't seen Mrs. Sirwicky for a week. If this keeps up, the old gal will be able to retire. But look, I didn't get hypnotized to be Joe Honor Roll. I did it to patch things up with Francis, which isn't working out so hot. And that's not all. Turning into Mr. Clean is ruining all my hobbies. I can't play soccer with the guys because, don't laugh, I'm worried about getting grass stains on my pants. How lame is that? Oh, and want to read the latest edition of Lukewarm Private Eye? Well, you can't. I ripped it into a zillion pieces because I couldn't make it perfect enough.
Ah, Nate, just the young man I'm looking for.
Huh? What does he want? I'm used to Principal Nichols looking for me, but not with a smile on his face. It's a little creepy.
Congratulations, Nate. I've decided to make you a hall monitor.
Me? Okay, now it's a lot creepy. Remember who else is a hall monitor? Nick Blonsky. Need I say more? I don't really think I'm the hall monitor type.
Oh, I disagree, Nate, he continues. Thanks to the recent change in your behavior, you're exactly the hall monitor type. Go see Mrs. Shapolsky. She'll give you your badge.
A badge? Why not just stamp loser on my forehead? It's pretty much the same thing.
Oh, no! Nate!
Teddy approaches.
Who died?
What do you mean? I ask. Teddy chuckles and tugs on my tie.
Just for a funeral!
Hey, I say. Careful, you'll wrinkle it.
He'll wrinkle it? Listen to me. I sound like a complete dork wagon. Oh, Nate!
Dee Dee calls out. You look so dashing. I love your tie.
Just don't touch it,
Teddy warns Dee Dee.
You might ruin Nate's swanky outfit.
I never said that, I snap.
You might as well have,
Teddy growls. Dee Dee jumps in. Guys, guys! It's bad enough that Nate and Francis are fighting. Don't you two start.
Ooh, look. Psst, let me see. How much do you think it's worth? Psst, ha ha.
That's just what I saw the other day, Dee Dee whispers excitedly. Randy's showing off the camera he stole from your locker, Nate.
Teddy frowns.
How do you know?
She shakes her head. I don't know exactly, but I'm going to find out by putting my theatrical training to use.
What's she talking about?
Teddy whispers. I shrug. Who knows?
I try not to spend any time inside Dee Dee's head.
Good point, Teddy snickers. That's a weird neighborhood.
We watch as Dee Dee strolls casually over to Randy and his posse, then...
Oh, my goodness,
Dee Dee exclaims.
I'm feeling dizzy.
Flump.
She hits the floor like a sack of potatoes. Randy drops something, but it's not the camera. I hear him angrily whisper to his friends as he stoops to the floor.
Pick them up, you idiots! Pick them up!
Pick what up? What are those? Teddy asks.
Beats me,
I answer as Dee Dee climbs shakily to her feet.
Whoo!
Dee Dee says.
Sorry about that. I must have fainted.
Well, go faint somewhere else, Randy snarls. And stop bugging us!
Oh, my head,
Dee Dee sighs. Dee Dee wobbles away from Randy and his gang like a leaky balloon, then finds Teddy and me around the corner.
What happened over there? We both ask.
Ahem, it's called acting. I gave such a convincing performance that Randy didn't realize I was collecting evidence.
Zip.
She holds something up.
Oh, let me see.
It's a gag me card.
Gag me number 53, Snotty Scotty.
Those aren't allowed at PS-38. If you get busted with them, you're in big trouble.
Well, that explains why Randy looked like he was hiding something, Teddy says.
He was.
I nod sadly. Yeah, but it wasn't the camera.
I'm beginning to think Randy's too stupid to steal a camera.
Dee Dee frowns.
Maybe someone else took it.
Teddy heaves a sigh.
Maybe, but who?
The bell rings. Time for homeroom.
Let's talk more about it later, during our free period,
Dee Dee suggests. I shake my head.
I'll have to wait till lunch. I've got hall monitor duty.
Which turns out to be as exciting as Mr. Galvin's rock collection. All you do is walk up and down the corridors. I feel like those old people who do laps around the mall.
Walk, walk, walk.
Whoa.
What's this?
It's Nick, but for a second I almost don't recognize him. He's walking really fast, and he's all hunched over. I take another look and...
Hey, he's got the camera!
Or does he? He's too far away for me to tell for sure, but he's got something tucked under his arm, and it sure looks like the camera. I take off after him.
Zow!
You're not supposed to run in the hallways, especially if you're a hall monitor, but this is an emergency. I kick it into overdrive and around the corner, then wham!
What idiot put a desk here?
I knocked it over and paper is scattered everywhere now. I scramble off the floor, ready to crank up my Nick chase again. He's already way ahead of me. I can't waste another second. Then I look around. The old me wouldn't have worried about a few papers on the floor. I would have sprinted after Nick like a crazed bloodhound. If I'm gonna get that stupid camera back, that's what I should do.
But I can't. Thanks a lot, Uncle Pedro. I start picking up all the sheets and stacking them on the desk. Not because I want to, because I have to. Being hypnotized leaves me no choice.
There, nice and neat.
Ring!
The lunch bell rings. The hallway fills up with people. Whatever chance I had to catch Nick red-handed is long gone. What a mess. Chapter 10.
That was the last straw,
I say, entering the cafetorium where Teddy and Dee Dee sit at a table.
What was? Dee Dee asks.
I just had a chance to solve the camera mystery, and I blew it, because I had to stop what I was doing and tidy up.
I tell Teddy and Dee Dee about seeing Nick with the camera and how he got away.
Aha! Dee Dee exclaims. I suspected Nick all along.
Teddy rolls his eyes.
Funny how you never mentioned that, Sherlock.
I can't take this anymore, I say miserably. I've had it with being neat. I want Uncle Pedro to unhypnotize me.
Sorry, dude, Teddy shakes his head. Uncle Pedro's visiting my grandparents in Mexico. He'll be back in a week.
A week? I'll never last that long.
Wait, Dee Dee says. Maybe you don't need Uncle Pedro.
I've heard that sometimes a dramatic event can snap a person out of a hypnotic trance.
What kind of dramatic event?
Dee Dee sighs. I don't know.
And you call yourself a drama queen?
I say. This'll cheer you up,
Teddy says.
Have some cheese doodles.
Okay, now we're talking. Cheese doodles make everything better, and I'm starving. I didn't eat breakfast this morning because I was obsessing about my hair, remember? I reach into the bag.
Ew! That's nasty,
I say. Wipe, wipe, wipe.
What's the matter?
Teddy asks. I got orange powder all over my hands. Wipe, 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 wipe. He makes a tell-me-something-I-didn't-know face.
Well, duh. Nobody can eat cheese doodles without getting all powdery.
Wipe, 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 wipe.
Yeah, says Dee Dee. The powder is what makes them so cheesy-licious.
And so messy, I say, pushing the bag away. Thanks, but no thanks.
Scoot!
Teddy's jaw drops. Dee Dee gasps.
Nate, you love cheese doodles, she says. You write poems about them.
I know. And now they disgust me. I lay my head on the table, after wiping it off with Teddy's napkin, and try to pull myself together. Francis hates me. None of my hobbies are fun anymore, and I can't even eat my favorite food in the whole world. What else could go wrong?
Ha! Hey, Butthurts! Hey, Butthurst! Hey, Butt Boy!
Knock it off!
I look across the cafetorium, and I feel like throwing up. Randy and his gang are harassing Francis. This is my fault. I spilled the beans about Francis's middle name. I might as well have painted a bullseye on his back. The blood starts pounding in my head. The lunchtime noises fade away until all I can hear is Randy's voice and his stupid laugh as he aims another kick at Francis's butt. I stand up, then I flip out. Wham! Fight! 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 Okay, true confessions time. I've never been in a real fight before, so jumping on Randy like a rabid Wolverine might not have been one of my better ideas, but it goes pretty well at first. In fact, I might actually be winning when...
Nate!
Mrs. Sirwicky grabs me.
What on earth are you doing?
He attacked me!
Randy whimpers, switching to victim mode in a millisecond. Mrs. Sirwicky nods grimly.
I saw it.
Not all of it,
comes a familiar voice.
You didn't see what Randy did first.
Mrs. C looks surprised.
This really doesn't concern you,
Francis,
he says helpfully.
Yes, well, thank you for your input, Francis, but it will be the principal's job to sort this out. Move along, Nate.
Great. Nothing like a little quality time with the big guy. I won't bore you with the details. Basically, he yells at me, nonstop, for about a half hour.
And obviously I'll be calling your father to discuss this incident. Now get back to class.
Yes, sir. I step into the hall and then...
Hey,
says Francis. Hey, I answer, trying to sound casual. He nods toward the principal's office.
What did he say?
Just what I knew he'd say, I snort, and we start walking. That I shouldn't have picked on poor innocent Randy. Francis shakes his head.
That's so bogus.
I shrug. I guess I did sort of ambush him, but he deserved it.
So,
Francis says.
Anyway, you got hypnotized, right?
Probably the stupidest thing I've ever done.
Why? I mean, it worked, obviously.
Yeah, I'm neater than you are now, I tell him. Check out my locker.
Wow! That's unbelievable,
Francis exclaims.
Considering what it used to look like, it's...
But I've stopped listening. My eyes are locked on a leather case tucked alongside the textbooks on the top shelf. I can't believe it. The camera! I examine the case. It's definitely the same camera, right down to the property of PS38 tag. Francis is flabbergasted.
What? How did... Nate, what's going on?
I'll tell you what's going on. Nick thinks he's being funny.
Nick Blonsky?
Francis asks in surprise.
That's my name, Nick says. Don't wear it out. What are you two doing out of class?
He smirks, flashing his hall monitor badge.
Oh, nothing, I reply angrily. Just looking at this camera, the one you stole from my locker.
He shrugs, pretending to be confused.
If I stole it, then how can you be holding it right now?
Because you put it back during third period. I saw you with it.
Another smirk. Maybe you did, and maybe you didn't,
he says in a sing-song voice.
I don't get it,
Francis says.
If you ended up putting it back, why'd you take it in the first place?
Because it was hilarious, Nick answers. That fight you two had when you realized the camera was gone was priceless. Ooh, you're a messy loser. Ooh, your middle name's Buttwad. Pinching that camera was the best thing I ever did.
What a twerp. I'm about 2 seconds away from my second fight of the day.
You're a riot, I snarl through gritted teeth.
We could report you to Principal Nichols for this,
Francis adds.
Go ahead, Nick says. Report your butt off. You can't prove anything.
Ahem. Are you sure about that? Dee Dee Holloway, super spy, at your service,
she says, taking a bow. The tiniest look of uncertainty creeps across Nick's face.
Super spy? Dee Dee smiles slyly.
You guys are having such an interesting conversation. I recorded it on my phone.
Pinching that camera was the best thing I ever did.
Nick turns pale. He backs away from us, slowly at first. Then he breaks into a run.
What's your problem? He says. It was a joke. Can't you take a joke?
I could hug Dee Dee. I don't, of course, but I could.
Dee Dee,
I tell her gratefully, that was
awesome.
Yep, the pigeon has landed,
she says, beaming. Then she grabs me and Francis.
But here's what's really awesome. Now you guys can be friends again. Kiss and make up, you two.
Well, if I didn't hug Dee Dee, I'm sure not gonna kiss Francis. I stick out my hand, and so does he, at the exact same moment.
Sorry.
Same here.
I shouldn't have accused you of losing the Cabra,
Francis says.
That was lame.
And I shouldn't have told the whole school your middle name, I admit. That was lamer.
This is fabulous,
Dee Dee squeals, hugging Francis to death.
There's nothing I adore more,
she continues, grabbing me,
than a happy ending.
Then, with a gasp, Dee Dee turns me loose.
Nate, there's food on your shirt.
Makes sense. An hour ago, I was rolling around on the cafetorium floor with Randy. So? I ask her.
And you don't care,
she says. Suddenly, it dawns on me what she's getting at.
I'm a slob!
Dee Dee's bouncing around like her hair's on fire.
Remember what I said? That a dramatic event might snap you out of it? Maybe your fight with Randy did the trick,
she says. That gives me an idea, I say. I fling open my locker, my disgustingly neat locker, and grab a pencil and paper. If I can draw something without worrying how perfect it is, then we'll know I'm not hypnotized anymore. I go as fast as I can. No rulers, no erasing, and by the time I'm finished, I can tell I'm myself again. Because this definitely isn't perfect. It shows Francis and me arm in arm, with Francis saying,
"No more fighting."
And I'm shouting, "You can say that again." Best friends. But it might be the most awesome drawing I've ever made. Chapter 11. Nick's not in school the next day, but we don't find out why until Francis, Teddy, and I walk into the Chronicle meeting after classes are over.
He got suspended? For a week, that's what I heard.
Hold it, I say. Nick gets to stay home from school? For a whole week? What a lucky stiff. That's way better than what I got. Principal Nichols gave me 3 days of detention for fighting with Randy. Then he called my dad. Guess what they talked about? Why, no, I didn't hear about what happened in the cafetorium. Back to the Chronicle meeting.
This meeting will now come to order,
Gina yells.
Bam, 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 bam.
Ugh, Gina and her stinking gavel. Couldn't we start the meeting with something a little mellower? Like a foghorn?
I've been working on some of these page layouts,
Gina announces as we gather around the table.
The group shots look really good, and these candids are spectacular.
Doc?
What are you trying to pull, Gina?
Teddy demands angrily.
You only use pictures of yourself and your snobby friends.
And besides, Nate was supposed to supply the candids,
Francis chimes in.
Yes, Gina says, but Nate never got around to it, did he? So I decided to handle it myself.
I'm afraid I can't allow that, Gina, says a voice from behind us. It's Mrs. Hickey.
You're a co-editor, not the boss. You can't do whatever you want without considering others.
Yes! Hickey to the rescue! Gina turns fire engine red, then corkscrews her face into a phony smile.
All right, she says, turning to Francis. What do you want to do?
Well, Nate just got the camera back yesterday, so I think he deserves some more time to take his pictures.
I agree, I add.
Mrs. Hickey nods.
I think that's a fair solution, but Nate, we do have a deadline, so no problem, I say immediately. I should get plenty of good candids tomorrow at the Trivia Slam.
The next morning as we walk to school, I realize two things. One, it's great to be friends with Francis again. And two, he's driving me completely insane.
Ludwig van Beethoven was born in 1770. The state bird of New Hampshire is the purple finch. The average temperature on Jupiter is minus 234 degrees Fahrenheit. The most popular TV show during 1963 was...
Enough practicing, I say. Enough practicing!
Nate's right, Teddy says. You're gonna fry your brain before the Trivia Slam even starts.
Francis takes a deep breath.
I know. But I'm worried about Gina's geniuses. They could beat us, you know.
They could,
but I still think we'll smuck 'em.
Francis's factoids versus Gina's so-called geniuses. Team member trivia specialties. Factoid Francis Pope, everything. Genius Gina Hemphill-Toms, everything.
And more!
Factoid Nate Wright. Comics, Ben Franklin, History of Snack Foods, Greek Myths.
Genius Eric Fleury.
Science Fiction, Martial Arts, Video Games. Factoid D.D. Holloway. Art, Drama, Fashion, Musical Theater. Genius... No info. Factoid Teddy Ortiz. Sports, Comedy, Foreign Languages, Movie Quotes.
Genius Mary Ellen Papowski.
Flute Music, Cosmetology, Reality Television. Factoid Chad Applewhite. Breakfast, Scouting, Lunch, Animals, Dinner.
Genius Nick Blonsky.
Computer Science, Math, Law Enforcement.
But Nick's suspended.
The cafetorium's already mobbed when we get there.
I wonder who Gina will get to replace Nick,
Teddy says as we squeeze through the door.
We don't have to wait long to find out.
Hey, fat turds, Randy says. Prepare to be crushed.
Oh, yeah?
Francis fires back.
Crushed by whom?
Wait, did he say whom? That's so Francis. Even when he's trash-talking, he uses good grammar.
By us, Randy crows. Gina's geniuses!
Teddy's mouth gapes open.
Is he serious? Why would Gina put an idiot like Randy on her team?
Francis ponders out loud.
You know, that actually might be smart.
Unlike Randy, Teddy says.
Randy's no Einstein, but he knows a ton of sports and movie trivia,
Francis explains.
Gina's team didn't have anybody like that before, so with Randy on the team instead of Nick, Gina's geniuses might have made themselves better.
Well, maybe, but there's no time to worry about it now. Ms. Clark is asking for quiet and explaining the rules.
You all know the format, she says. During the preliminary round, you may consult your teammates before answering each question. But during the final round, you must answer the questions without help.
That's when you'll fall flat on your face,
Gina whispers to me.
Shut up, I shoot back.
Shut up? That's the best snappy comeback I've got? Definitely not up to my usual standards. I must be nervous.
All right, then. Put on your thinking caps. It's trivia time.
You heard Miss Clark, factoids,
Dee Dee says as she reaches into her book bag.
Thinking caps on.
Leave it to Dee Dee to bring costumes into this. But whatever. If wearing dorky hats is going to help us take down Gina's geniuses, I'm all for it.
The first question is for Amanda's pony posse, Miss Clark announces. What is the largest of the 50 states?
Psst, Alaska. Yeah, Alaska. Psst, yeah.
Alaska.
Pretty easy, right? That's how the trivia slam works. The early rounds are always a cakewalk, but as the game goes on, the questions get harder.
What is the name of the rat in Charlotte's Web?
Templeton.
Who won Super Bowl IV?
The Kansas City Chiefs.
On a color wheel, what is the opposite of blue?
Orange?
And the candids get better and better. Click, 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 click.
Teams start dropping like flies. Trish's tater tots don't know the capital of Luxembourg.
I'm sorry, that's incorrect.
Trick question. It's Luxembourg. Artur's antelopes can't name the only vegetable that's also a flower.
Broccoli. Yuck.
Okay, thanks you anyway.
Eventually, just like everyone knew it would, it comes down to two teams. Francis's factoids and Gina's geniuses.
Okay, guys, here's where all our practicing pays off, Dee Dee whispers. Try to relax.
Relax? I can't relax when we're going toe-to-toe with Gina and Randy. You think they're obnoxious now? If they beat us, we'll never hear the end of it. And the game rolls on. One by one, everybody's answering questions from the stage.
Potassium.
Taxidermy.
Dental floss.
Hawaii.
Joe.
Darth Vader.
$50.
Ukulele.
Daisy Duck.
Purple.
A rhombus.
Water polo.
The Nile.
Zero.
Borscht.
Igor?
Nice job, Chad, I whisper as he steps down from the stage. He looks a little wobbly. The pressure's getting to everybody. And you know what they say about pressure? It breaks stuff. So who's gonna crack first?
Randy, Miss Clark says. You're up, and your category is sports.
Rats! A sports question. This'll be a no-brainer. Randy grins confidently.
At the beginning of a match, how many pawns are there on a chessboard?
The blood drains from his face.
Wait a minute, chess? Chess isn't a sport?
It's recognized as a sport by the International Olympic Committee, Miss Clark states matter-of-factly. Answer the question, please.
But Randy's not a chess player. He's more of a tic-tac-toe guy. Remember, you can't ask your teammates for help in the final round. Randy's gotta sink or swim on his own. And I've got a feeling he's going down.
Ten?
Randy answers.
Click, click, click.
Miss Clark shakes her head.
I'm sorry, the answer is 16. 8 per side.
Click, click, click.
Gina looks ready to wring Randy's neck. I'm snapping pictures as fast as I can, and Dee Dee's about to launch into the victory dance she's been rehearsing all week. But it's not over yet.
If the factoids answer the next question incorrectly, the game continues, Miss Clark says. If they get it right, they're the champions. Nate, you're up.
I walk up on stage.
Your category is phobias. The question is, if you suffer from allurophobia, what are you afraid of?
I look over at Francis. He flashes me a gigantic smile.
Why?
Because he knows the same thing I do. We're about to win the trivia slam. The answer is cats.
That's correct. Miss Clark smiles.
I don't hear the rest. Dee Dee wraps me in a bear hug, and a second later, I'm on the bottom of a factoid pig pile. Teddy's singing in Spanish, hats are flying everywhere. It's total pandemonium.
I thought we were doomed when I heard that question,
Chad exclaims as we untangle ourselves.
I mean, oh, you're a what? Nate, how did you know that?
Before I can answer, Francis slaps me on the shoulder.
He's just really good at trivia, that's all.
But that's not all, and Francis knows it better than anybody. Actually, the real reason I knew it is, I'm afraid of cats.
Blush.
See, that was my half of the friendship pact I made with Francis back in third grade. He told me his secret, Butthurst, and I told him mine, that I'm a complete cat coward.
I know it sounds stupid, but cats just freak me out. They always have.
That's okay, Nate, Dee Dee says. Lots of people have phobias.
Yeah, Teddy says. I'm not very good with heights.
I'm afraid of snakes and clowns and yogurt,
Chad says.
Think of it this way,
Francis says.
If you weren't Eilerophobic, we might have lost Agena.
And Randy,
Teddy says.
Oh, guys,
that reminds me, I say. I got a great shot of Gina at the exact moment Randy gave the wrong answer. It's a clear shot of Gina freaking out and looking awful.
Can't wait to see that in the Chronicle,
Dee Dee calls out. As the others scroll through the rest of the pictures, Francis and I step into the hall.
Hey, I just thought of something,
he says.
Maybe Uncle Pedro could help you get over your cat phobia.
No, thanks. Being hypnotized the first time didn't work out so hot. He chuckles.
Yeah, I'm glad that didn't stick. I like you much better as a slob.
Hear that? Now that's a best friend. We'll always be total opposites, but just because Francis is Mr. Clean, it doesn't mean he expects me to be. He's happy with me just the way I am. That's pretty neat.